Et voilà, le stream est... don't even know what the French term for has... the French phrasing for has started is. Anyway, the stream has started now and the recording too, so let's get into things and do things. I don't need messages right now. Okay, so inside Emacs, here's the now.app. This is the third episode in the series. I haven't reached any particular milestone last time, which is a bummer. But we talked about testing and yeah, here's a test that I started and where I then stopped doing things. Why did I stop doing things? Because it was really hard to reason about these things, because I essentially ended up with legacy code here. Let's check the screen size. I think this font size should work as well. So I zoomed out a bit. What we've got here is this is a helper I copied from the interwebs that does a URL request and then changes it into a combine publisher, which is compatible with SwiftUI components. So this is doing the spinny thing, the loading indicator. It's doing the updates for that. But this code is hard to test, harder to test than other code, because here actual data publishers are being used. To check how these, and so this is one problem. This function uses actual internet using infrastructure, and I can't replace that. Because there's, I can replace the URL, which is based on the string parameter, but this is an actual URL session. So to test this function, I would have to replace this call with something else, where I can stub in a replacement. But when I stub in a replacement, the data publisher, data task publisher is a. Yeah, let's look at this. If I would stub the request. How do I create a data task publisher? Okay. And I use the handle events method. Not even sure if handle events. Okay, let's look at this. Okay, it's not from a protocol which data task publisher conforms to. It's part of the data task publisher itself. The data task publisher is a struct. So you can make a subclass and override the handle blah blah method and then essentially create a fake variant of this. So you mocking this is a bit of work. It's not hard work, and I know techniques to do this, but I don't like any of these in particular. One is to create a protocol that I own and then that exposes this method, then make the data task publisher conform to that, and then provide a replacement instead of a real data task publisher which conforms to this protocol that I just invented. I create a mock instance in my test code, and then the same protocol methods can be used still, but it will be calling the test double. So that's one way to do this. But if possible, I would like to do this differently. This is a function, and this function is not mock. It's hard to mock this because it's not a dependency that's injected. It's part of the code itself. So I would have to inject the URL request and or the URL session, not sure. And I used these to figure out why compiling didn't work. These are not necessary anymore. And here the function is used. And one change I did already was to inject this parameter. Instead of reachable URL, the free function being called immediately, I can now inject a replacement function. So I don't have to test this and the URL task stuff and how network requests have to be stopped and then these things. I can leave this to for later. What I will have to test is a function, or provide a function that takes a string, a network activity publisher, which is a side effect publisher, so to speak, and which returns an any publisher, which is basically a promise of either the URL, no URL, or, well, it's not supposed to create an error. So we expect an optional URL. And this can be, I can inject something else in tests here, and that's quite nice for a start. So, and the URL resolver, that's the signature of the function. We don't need object for this, was also part of the figuring out why compiling didn't work, and I was just too stupid to set up the project correctly. Okay, so I can inject this, and since I can inject this, let's see how far I got in the tests. Given a fake resolver that creates an activity side effect, true and then false in the end, and returns nil. It is injected here. So the validator, URL page, the URL validator will do this. It starts with is performing network activity false. And then I expect when the request starts that the side effect changes to true by virtue of this activity publisher event. The result should be nil. And in the end, it should be false again. So this is a naive way to sketch this. And I don't know exactly why I started with this last time, but what I see here is it's a sketch. Why do I know it's a sketch? Because this to the right side there's this code where asynchronous stuff is happening. It's using combined publishers, it's subscribing to changes, there's a sync involved somewhere which receives the changes or something. I think you can call the published URL property a sync. This one. Not sure about the terminology. We're all learning here, right? So the events trickle down to the valid URL property. And with that, with the asynchronous nature and the combine subscriptions that are happening, this to the left side, what you see to the left side in the code here is not going to work. This is expecting like this. This is imperative code. This is a query, a getter being called, and it can't be both at the same time. There's nothing happening in between, you know? So what I have to transform this to first true, then the valid URL should be nil, and then the network activity should be false again. I have to transform this into subscriptions that fire off, okay, this happened, then this happened, then this happened. What we've got here is code I copied from Mocha Geo's test-driven development book. Must be somewhere around here. Wait a second. Where's the page donkey? Where's the camera? Yeah, camera. Test-driven development in Swift. Has a couple of very, very good sections on Swift UI testing and view model testing and combine. Swift UI is reactive by its very nature. Oh, the false is there. Sorry. Don't need it here. Expect it in the end. So Swift UI is reactive by its very nature. And Mocha Geo does a good job. Geo Lodi does a good job at explaining how to write tests that subscribe to changes like this. So he's creating, in his example, he was having this view model type. It publishes events here. It's a sections, I think a publishable where the sections can be inspected. It's a what's it called? Property wrapper. Yes, and he's dropping the first value. Why is he dropping the first value? Because we're not interested in the initial value here, which is nil, which is the empty string, which is false. We're interested in changes, so we're dropping that first value, and then we wait for changes to happen. So we subscribe not to the to the stream of changes of reachable URL events. We are injecting these, and then we look at the effects on the validator. We are looking at effects on these published properties. Let's have a look. Could also mean that this is in fact not a validator, but a view model. Not sure. And in Geo's terms. So this would be classic synchronous and imperative testing, but we can't do that. What we are able is to write a validator test, which takes, see here the publishers themselves prefixed by the dollar sign, and they are inspectable directly. We can do that. So we want to see is performing network activity. It's a Boolean. Check that first. Okay. We drop the first value. We check this here already, and then we want to assert that. Value is true. The cancelables. Does he usually do I have this open in my recent? Test-driven development. Which chapter was it? Statics with UI views, dynamic networking. Let me open the yes, internet. I trust everything from the internet. Where does he create the cancelable? Is it in the start? Is it in the end? What was this view? Maybe menu item tests. Where do the cancelables come from? Nope. Aha. Okay, so he's just setting these up in the beginning. Is that how you do it in combine? Now what? We don't need an optional if we can just replace the whole set. Why am I doing it this way? Because when tests run in parallel, I want to make sure that once a test case has finished, that everything is being torn down, and not that I don't want to wait until the test object is being released, which might be later. So tests overlap and then events cross pollinate each other. I'm doing this out of habit because I was bitten by this in my early days a lot when I relied on notifications, and then the notification fired for all tests that were still living in memory, wasn't very useful. Store in range replaceable collection. I think that's. Oh, that's the one. Okay. Store in consolables, and then we don't. Yeah, we should wait for asynchronous expectations. This is going to be tricky. We have various changes. So we have this both. First it should be true, then it should be false. We expect multiple events. Either we can do this like this. You see, this looks quite odd. And when we reach this point, we also can say that we have finished with with an asynchronous expectation. Why be descriptive when we don't know what's going to happen yet? Is expectation fulfill? We expect two of them. I think this can be created differently. This would almost be what I want. I want this to be a block. I want a block-based expectation. I don't want to use key value observation or predicates. I want to... Didn't I write something like this in the past? Anyway, let's go with the... If missing, excuse me. Okay, so this is one piece of the puzzle. We also want to wait for... one piece of the puzzle, but the other piece is still missing, the valid URL. Also ignore the first value, the initial value, and then we expect nil. What's the value? It publishes an optional URL. Okay, yeah, of course, because this is bound to URL, not to the fact that we are having I was looking at this, and then I thought, oh, well, who's sending the error case? Is this part of the value? No, the value is just the value. But we also need to notify about the asynchronous event having happened. This is going to be my favorite way to indent this. Did receive URL invalid? No, don't need that. When are we going to change text? That's the input. Oops. That is the input. Yes. Didn't I have this at the bottom here? No. Okay, so received string is a block-based variable that captures the incoming string, which is the string for the URL. Unique URL strings. Okay, so this is the programmatic change. Also, not sure, do I have to make this asynchronous? Received string should be invalid. Let's try this. It's aptly named, was written to but never read. No, that's not true anymore. I remember run this on the iPhone simulator because Xcode, what's it called, 13.0 does not contain the Monterey SDK and the recent Mac stuff anymore, which makes this not compile for Mac. Yeah, I didn't like that. I hope since yesterday the new MacBooks were announced and Monterey should ship in the near future, I think in the upcoming couple of weeks, we should be having fun with Xcode 13.1 or something and the macOS SDK again. I didn't actually intend to run it, I just ran it out of habit. Game is back. Oh, I'm not hearing myself. Is it good or is it bad that I'm not hearing myself? Test, test, test. Okay. OBS is picking something up. My monitor is picking something up. I'm visible again. Okay, that's good. So, thanks. You wonky USB hub. Oh, and I once I get the... None of the hubs will fit. But then again, we have regular USB input again. And SD card readers and the new MacBook Pros. Let's see what the peripheral situation is going to be when they arrive. It's not the very of today. Okay. This is a new input. I'm in the camera again. Everything's working. Okay, here's input, and I expect this to be the same. That's the expectation. From true to false. Received valid URL update, and we're asserting that this is going to be the URL. URL stub. It's not test driven. So since it is not test driven, it's hard to say what would be a good. It's not hard per se. It's just not as easy to say what would be a good start. You could just as well say, okay, the test should fail at first, and then we make it green. So this would be an expected failure case, because here's the assertion, the quality assertion, and it should now not be passing. That's all right. So that appears to work. Test again. And we're golden. Now that the tests are working, we can refactor, but not refactor the code. It doesn't do much at the moment. We're basically just testing the sequence here. We're not testing what's happening inside reachable URL. We're just testing that the strings are being passed on and stuff like that. Immediately invalidate when the user types. So while the test is incoming and while this has not reached. So we are expecting two updates. First to nil immediately, and then once the reachable URL has finished, whatever it returns. And in one case it returns nil as well, in one case it returns a valid URL. How do we test the transition here? The same way? I didn't like this. Didn't like this, but I'm going to copy the approach. At the moment. Okay, increment. At first. Value should be nil. But then. This should happen. Oops. And there also should not be a third time. Two times. Whoops. This needs to change. Clipboard history, please. Thank you. Okay. Try to test. Copy paste without paying attention didn't work. 2 nils should be received. What's the test? Blah blah blah. Receives valid URL update twice. Is this maybe? No, this is not working as well. This expectation is too late. We have to set this up first. Because this is doing the change immediately. Mm-hmm, I see, I see. The obnoxious move banner is in my face, but I want to get this out of the way before I do the short work break. Please, now, 2 events. It's a timing problem, isn't it? Is my copy pasting? Did I break something? Copy pasting again? Optional. Oops. Empty string is not equal to invalid URL. Think before you paste. I did it correctly here, but not at the top. Please now work. Oh, looks good. Yes. Yes. The tests run. But the tests are now kind of weird. I'm zooming in for maximum overview. Doing a quick web break for 5 minutes. And what I'm going to do, with this setup, you can't see, but I'm going to do, there's a pull-up bar in one of the doors. Have a couple of weights, just moving, get blood flow going, stretch my hips because I'm sitting all day, some mobility for the wrists so they don't hurt from all the typing. So everything to stay not in shape as in getting stronger, but stay in shape as in not rotting away in front of the desk. Very important. Can recommend. Okay, see you in 5 minutes. So, let me catch my breath for a second. Work breaks, yes, very useful, can recommend all the time, every day. Since I do them some 8, maybe 10 years now, rather consistently, I never had any RSE problems since then. When I was younger, I had a feeling of what's it called? From the tilting, tenting, pronating, supinating. No, I think this is pronating, supinating. What's this? I mean, this movement. You know, like it hurt here. So, right here. Not anymore since then. I think it's more or less the consensus of the research that you can't out-train the problems of sitting, but you can at breaks to make sitting suck less, so to speak. Anyway, where's my headphones? Okay, anyway, here we are with ugly tests. Let's commit ugly tests, yes. What are we actually testing? Test URL. Validation from input. Might as well push. Yep. Of course, there is a GitHub repository. So we can check out the code. Okay, why did I commit and push? Because this is ugly and I want the world to see it. Now we're going to clean this up. This didn't change much. We have a... This is state, more or less. Mutable state, expectation coming in from the outside. This closure is always doing the same thing. Having a true false switch for the activity publisher, and it returns a value. We can extract this. Let's start with the class. And the class is called foo. Why foo? Because I don't know what a good name is, and this is a very good placeholder until later. Okay. Handle request, could make this a function, can keep this as a property, so we can reuse the type alias here. Doesn't really matter. Blah blah blah. Maybe we have to use a function because mutating self. It was any publisher URL. No boolean URL. I think. Not sure. This has to be injected exceed test in expectation. Any publisher, that's not it. Publish subject. Publish. Okay. What's this? Pass through subject, of course. Bool never. Yes. Just return. I could either curry this. Do I want to curry this? Yes. Because now, validator, I can return the resolver again. Which is this, and it depends on the URL result. Will this work with mutating struct? I think it won't. Is this the most efficient way to write this? Probably not. Okay, this will work now. Request handler double. I want one of this kind, and it should be the expectation has to be created here, and it's a okay. My typing is weak. On camera. Okay. We've replaced the closures, which were looking the same, with, yes, it works, with a test double that encapsulates the closure stuff and has only the URL result. Result is a weird name. Maybe rather URL stub. What does Geo call this? This he's calling a spy, which is more or less accurate. Yeah, I think that can work. Just a string, okay. Nothing fancy. I wanted to see what the what his idea of good names are. Alas, I don't see comparable names. Sometimes it's a spy, because it's spying on the process. Sometimes it's not a spy, but a stub. He is replacing the whole view model. Request handler double. This should be called something else. Yeah, the refactoring thing doesn't allow splitting named parameters and the actual parameters internally. So I have to do the two steps. Okay, how does this read? Reachable URL, request handler, double URL resolver, returning nil, returning URL stub. I like this part. Request handler double, I don't like that name. It's also not a request handler double, it's a... This is not the double, it's a double factory. Do I want to say factory? Bit icky, we're not in Java territory here. But still better than nothing, I guess. It doesn't work. It creates a closure. It's a factory part, but it also captures the string that's passed in. So it can be used only once. It's not stateless. So it is itself actually a double. Okay. So what about the rest here? On the test again, then we commit the refactoring of the test. We don't say refactor in the commit message, we say what kind of refactoring we're doing. We did extract handling URL request expectations in tests. I hope I get better at naming these asynchronous things, because the names at the moment, I'm not really convinced they're the best names that exists. What I still don't like is this valid URL receive count. I want to write expectation that two things happened. I want to collect, instead of a sync, can I collect when it finishes? Does it ever finish? I don't know. Collect two. Sorry, the jumping up and down is because my caps lock is rebound to home, which scrolls all the way up, but also when I hold it down to control. So I actually wanted to make to type a control based shortcut but I released the key too early and then triggered the home key. I wanted to control I for indent. Will this work? I have no clue. It's still going to wait for the expectation. But is it ever going to finish? Will it finish if I wait for three events? And I know there are not going to be three events, because I'm pretty sure there's not going to be a completion. Yeah. Many times out. Okay. This is not half bad. This is actually not half bad. What we lose is the test for more than three events. But also when this is being triggered, and if no other expectation is awaited, this is never going to happen because we are already in this territory by then. Asynchronous code is... not easy. Uh-oh. Do I want to put this in one line? Do I want to put this in two lines? I think I like the extra space here. I'm not sure. Okay. Copy. And here we expect value, double nil. Expect nil twice. We expect the same true false. This doesn't change between tests. Can and should we extract this? I don't know yet. These comments aren't useful either anymore. I used them as guidance last time, but this time we are way beyond that. Okay, here's the setup. Let's drop this. Just the initial values, no request being made, so we don't have to check here for the precondition, which was what the validator started with. Form of the verb. Let's check. No native speaker. Receipt noun. No, I want the verb past passive progressive. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's receival. Oh, wait. It's a noun. That's received the event reception. Yes. The receipt of his letter threw into ecstasy. Event received throughs imperative code into ecstasy as well. That's good. Replace imperative event receipt tests with... more or less what we did here. Simplify. Collect two. You can also wait. Yeah, this sucks. Okay, let's ask a proper documentation browser. Collect. Hello. Yes, 10 similar results. Any publisher? Collect all of them, but there is no all. Almost. Timing group strategy used by the operator to collect and publish scheduler options. Please example. Aha, timer publish. Collect by time. So I could wait here. Collect for 5 seconds. But it will always wait 5 seconds. Not helpful, but also collect by time, run loop main seconds. Really nice API. Damn. Test again to verify it didn't break anything. I'm expanding to two panes to see what we have here. Okay. Now, is this a validator? Because there's no... Is this a URL view model? URL status view model? Does the preview work? Oh, jittery. This is not going. Do I want to make the validator a view model instead? While this is loading, let's ask what Geo is doing. Order detail dot view model. How is he nesting his stuff? There's the extension on order detail and there's a view model inside. That's all there is. What is order detail? It's itself a view and it has an observed object. Fair enough. Same here. I don't think the preview is producing any result anytime soon. Okay. Let's be fancy. Call this view model. Go to the validator. Rename the file. URL status view. Yes. URL status view model. One type per file. I like that. Now the file name has changed. Compilation should still work, but you never know with Xcode. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Often doesn't work. Okay, it does work this time. Also need to rename this. Bam. Renamed in the project as well. Still building. Don't know what it's taking so long, but failed. Because I renamed while it was building, sorry. Sorry. Yep. No underscore, no nothing. Status view, view model test. Oops. Yes, I'm still sticking to the view suffix. It's just URL status, maybe? Not sure. Too greedy. We have dependency injection in the initializer, so we don't need to have internally or publicly changeable or mutable properties here. Whoops, this is not going to work. This is, yes. Okay, okay. Please compile. No. What do you mean? In the test, yeah, could be, but we're still focused on this. Now page URL view. Oh no. The URL the data is used again. What is this doing? Scribbling the text. And this is setting up the validator. That was a weird choice. The status view is just the loading indicator. Kind of makes sense that the view model, maybe it shouldn't be the status view view model, but the now page URL view view model. Should they share view models? Should I make derived view models from this? And in the form, there it is created. Here's no preview. We're done there. Forward again. lean on the compiler, they said. Did I not capitalize the URL status view? I did, I'm pretty sure. What we gain from the type alias is we can change this later without copy pasting all over the place. Again. Why? Staus, no status. Typo. Acceptable. All right. Yep. Lots of typos. I copy pasted this and then I noticed that the status pumora. Also here, status, and also here, Twitch chat. Why didn't you tell me? Status view model. All right, looks good enough. Still weird that the view model is inside the URL status view. Yes, it is weird. We have a multi-component thing here. What would Geo do? Order detail has a view model, blah, blah, blah. In the status view model, we only need let's make two panes again. Okay, what do we need? We have a view model, and the view model is only being tested for its Boolean property here. Is this valid, yes or no? The rest is irrelevant. So we could make two view models of this. One view model that performs the actual important stuff, and one view model that takes this as input, or this as input, and then transforms it to something else. But is that what the pros do? What is this view model? It has an order controller, payment processing, and it has, where's the outputs? String this observable by default? I don't think so. Next view model. What does this do? Menu item. Okay, it transforms to string. Menu fetching, which is probably doing something like the requests we're doing, if I remember the example correctly. And it publishes sections. Menu sections contain categories, menu items. Okay, this fetches JSON. Oh, wait, here's the camera. It fetches JSON from the web. There's the camera. Fetches JSON from the web, then transforms it into the domain model, which is menu section and menu item. It's nested and grouping them somehow. And then you get the grouping applied, and then there's the result. Yes, and the result is the published published sections property here. It's interesting that this is a result and not a publish something something, a publisher. Quite like it, but I don't want to deal with errors. Not in the status view, at least. There it's okay if it just displays valid URL, yes, no. Okay, let's make two view models of this, because this is doing too much for our purpose. Okay, this is not going to be the URL status view model anymore. This is going to be the add now page form view model. Okay, everyone. Sorry. Here the audio, the original audio from the stream cut off, and also during the stream the audio cut off, probably because my USB hub is a bit flimsy and disconnected partially, I'm not sure. What I did here is I moved the view model from the URL status view namespace, and the URL status view model was thus renamed to add now page form view model. And with that change, I wanted to introduce and prepare for the next time one thing. That is, I wanted to prepare a view model that is tailored to the URL status view. The URL status view, it's just a loading indicator paired with, is this a valid URL or is it not a valid URL? It has three states: pending, valid, invalid, and also, it turned out, an initial state when nothing has yet been typed into the field. And that should display an empty view or view, or display nothing rather. And I was sketching in the last couple of minutes. I think it was like 15 minutes or so that I spent with this. In the last couple of minutes, I wanted to prepare a new view model for URL status view that has two inputs: the valid URL or nil, and the is network request pending boolean. And both are the inputs, and the output is a state that has one of three cases: initial, which is nothing has happened yet, pending, invalid, and valid. And I wanted to make the code compile so that I don't have to worry, so that I next time don't have to worry about making the new name work. And then I broke the functionality that is missing again. So I basically cheated. I introduced the new type, I made it do nothing, then I checked that it runs so that I can start with the implementation and the tests right away. And instead of returning this dummy state, I then removed the dummy state, and that's it. So see you next time. I hope you have a great rest of your day, and thank you for watching.